Good evening to all the participants. I welcome you on behalf of Madras Tax Bar. Today is a big day for us. We are celebrating our 100th webinar. The theme of our webinar has been being socially distanced but intellectually connected. So I thank you all for joining us today. So before we move on to the agenda of our meeting, I just want to make few announcements with regard to the rules. First, Mr. Jay Kumar will be giving a highlight of our 100 webinars. And thereafter, Mr. Pramod Chopra will be welcoming our guest speaker today, His Lordship Justice, Dr. Justice Vineet Kothari. And thereafter, His Lordships will go on with his session. And once my lords finish his session, we will have the question answer round, where you can raise your hands to ask questions. And I request the participants to kindly confine your questions within the topic so that we will try to make the session as interactive as possible. I once again welcome all of you to this 100th webinar, and I thank my lords for joining the session and consenting to take this. I call upon Mr. JK, as we fondly call him, to give him to give the highlights of our 100 webinars. Thank you.
Thank you, Prithvi. Very good evening, Lordship. I'm given a very wonderful task of running through the 100 webinars. Prithvi, can you allow me to share the screen, please? Because that is disabled.
Given, sir.
Yeah.
Oh.
Lords, we have a small PPT which will run for between 5 to 7 minutes, where we'll take lordship through what all we did in this during this lockdown period. My lords, it started because it was an introduction to you. I will be addressing lordship, and it will be for the entire gallery also. We started this during this lockdown period when everyone was distressed. This Madras Tax Bar, there was a small initiative, as I quote Victor Hugo, and a small idea which was brought by none other than the host, Mr. Prithvi. He once wrote on April 11th stating that, why can't we have a kind of a webinar which is coming up and share knowledge, and that too particularly about GST. That is how this entire session started, and our first session started on 11th of April during the prime of the lockdown period. My lords, I have to honestly confess that at that point, we never knew that this is going to cross. First, whether it will kickstart was a question. Once it kickstarted, then we never knew that it would cross 5 or 10. But today, I stand before you, Lordships, presenting a voyage of 100, around 100 webinars with a theme. In fact, we have coined a theme for this webinar series, because I think after 100, we are worth the tagline. And the tagline goes like this: socially distanced, intellectually connected. That is what exactly the theme we have done this 100. My lords, I'll be just going through only the highlights and the milestones what we did in another next 5 minutes. Our webinar was studded with or decorated with a fine array of honorable judges in one of the finest sessions the webinar ever had, on women power in the judiciary, where three finest judges of the Madras High Court, Justice Pushpa Satyanarayana, Justice Anita Sumanth, and Justice Pete Asha, came and addressed the gathering and also took questions and initiated such a wonderful webinar series. Then, my lords, Honorable Justice G.R. Swaminathan from Madurai bench of the Madras High Court came and gave a very, very important lecture on the COFEPOSA Act, which was his absolute speciality. Lords, also had the privilege of two great judges, Justice Rajiv Shakdev and our own home judge, Mr. M. Sundar, coming and talking on the product of tribunalization, a product of backlog and delays. There was a panel discussion, and it was conducted by Aparna Ananda Kumar and Natarajan. Lots. Then, as another very important session we had, where Mr. A.K. Jayashankaran Nambiar of Kerala High Court, judge came and gave a very, very important lecture on the effective control of delegated legislations in India, where he touched upon very interesting nuantic points and also clarified many questions of the participants. Last but not the least, my lords, we also had the privilege of Justice K. Kannan, retired judge from Madras and Punjab and Haryana High Court. I'm told that he is a very close friend of lordships. He came and gave a wonderful lecture on art of negotiation and new skills for the lawyers. And that is how this webinar series was completely decorated by an array of wonderful judges. My lords, then I just move on to the seniors who came and gave extraordinary lectures in this 100 webinar series, starting from Mrs. V. Mohana, senior advocate, who gave a lecture on Article 136. And then we had senior E. Om Prakash, who gave on SARFAZI and IBC. Then Mr. V. Sridharan from Delhi came and gave a constitutional perspective of GST. Our own son of the soil, N. Venkatraman, a senior advocate, he came 4 or 5 times and gave very fine, they were all fantastic lectures. One on latest SC rulings, Supreme Court rulings, and one on a black money story. And then we had the advantage, the privilege of Mr. A.R. Sundaresan, senior advocate. Then we also had our in-house senior advocate, Pushya Sitaraman, talking on exemptions for the charitable trust, along with Hema Murali Krishnan. She gave a fine lecture on that. Then we also had shareholders' rights, mergers and amalgamations from senior advocate Murari. Guru Krishna Kumar, senior advocate, came from Delhi and gave a completely new subject on floor test and the court issues and perspectives. Then R. Venkatraman, senior advocate, on arbitration. And finally, A. Thyagarajan, senior advocate, gave a very great insight on the Evidence Act in quasi-judicial proceedings, particularly in tax laws. Well, lords, apart from this, we also touched upon very crucial aspects of this emerging law tax, GST, wherein starting from the definitions, there were lectures on definitions, supply, place of supply, composite supply, time of supply, all important ingredients of GST has been touched upon to a very greater length and breadth of the law with a fine perspective as well as their experience coupled with so many speakers came from outside as well as in-house resources, came and gave lectures. There was on valuation, we touched upon classification, exports, cross-charge, anti-profiteering, and we touched upon the latest advance authority rulings also. Likewise, we went on to deal with ITC, transitional credit, and works contract. Works contract, I have to mention I have to make a special mention, my lords. We had a 3-compartment session on works contract, starting from its genesis. Till date, it was finally captured in-house by Raghavan Raghamudran. And there was also a panel discussion of equal representation of judicial members in GST tribunals. These are a glimpse I'm taking lordship through the various topics we have touched upon during this 100 series. And in income tax, there was equally a very vibrant lectures given by Swaminathan, so many speakers, and gave wonderful lectures like on international taxation, transfer pricing, then all the basic tenets of the IT Act, GAT valuation. Mr. Lakshmi Kumar from Delhi came and gave a fine exposition. Search assessment was done, then review, revision, rectification, cash loans, and one of the finest is capital and revenue expenses and receipts was taken by, again, Mr. Swaminathan. An alternate dispute resolution was taken. So in IT also, we have touched upon nearly the entire layout of the Act with a very great insight. That is very, all the lectures which are available on YouTube, lords, will give you a complete picture of the efforts which has gone in each lecture of it. Well, lords, apart from this, we also touched upon out-of-the-box miscellaneous topics like AAG Narmada Sampath Kumar came and gave 2 great lectures on due process of law and right to life under Article 21. Then S.R. Rajgopal AAG also came up and gave a fine lecture on pandemic and constitution. Then we touched upon REITs, equality law, the new, very new one which is yet to come, equalization levy by Mr. Vijay Kumar and Raghavan again. Cyber crimes and financial frauds by Napid Nai, who came from Delhi to take a very special lecture on that. Then we had export promotions. Then cross-examination customs was done by a trio, including Mr. A.P. Srinivas. Then there was e-filing procedures by all government councils came together and explained to us how it has to be filed. Then on Prevention of Money Laundering Act, there was an overview. Then on RERA and IBC, Mr. Vaidheeswaran came and gave a lecture. And we also had force majeure and environmental regulations during and post COVID-19. But this is a very, very great USP of our, this I need to stop here for a, pause here for a while and mention to Lordship that this entire series conceived, conducted, run through by a great, I would say a great battalion of youngsters. And this group is, the average age index of this group should be around 35 only because of the great youngsters we have. We have around 70 to 80 youngsters in this group who are absolutely motivated, and they also came up with finally when an opportunity was given them to give presentations. They came up with the fine lectures, including Prithvi, who is hosting today, Mr. Nitin, Mr. Aditya Reddy, and so many people. So they came up with various fine topics like GST assessment, GST returns, demand recovery and appeals, constitutional morality was touched upon by Mr. Bharati, a son of Mr. N. Venkatraman, on a very, very interesting topic on constitutional morality. Then GST on alcohol was touched upon. Then finally, on a time limit for GST on transitional credits was also taken up. So I pause to impress Lordship that this slide is a very important slide of the entire webinar series, where young guns in their shoulders took the entire series to a greater heights. Well, then we had some exclusives, which we'll run through it 2 minutes and finished off. We had one exclusive session on photography, then on psychology, then on nutrition, which is very, very important. A very fine lecture was given by a nutritionist. Then on COVID also, there was a doctor who came and gave a lecture on life after COVID. On COVID also, we did this. Lots. These are the very, very important ones which I consider as the milestones of our webinar series. On professional ethics and legal for legal practitioners, 3 great seniors, N.L. Raja, N. Venkatraman, and C. Manishankar, came and gave a great account of for all the youngsters and even for our generation. It was a fine lecture on that. And then Mr. N. Venkatraman once again came with this very spiritual touch on way to God and way to profession and gave a wonderful lecture motivating all the youngsters and navigating them into the right path. My lords, this is very important. We also, this was an opportunity for us to pay a tribute to immortal legends, where we had 2 sessions, one at the 50th session on a golden jubilee and then on the 60th at Sashtiabdha Murthy. On both the sessions, we had 2 great sessions where we tried to pay tribute to greatest immortal legends this profession has ever had, starting from Habibullah Basha, C. Natarajan, and the list goes on till Mr. D.T. Chopra. We had a wonderful tribute paid by great stalwarts, current contemporary stalwarts. They came up and in fact, they passed on the baton. What made them immortal was transmitted to the our generation, the future generation, very well by very great speakers. Then, my lords, Mr. Arvind Dattar, he came up with, he completed 40 years of his bar experience, and he was very kind enough to come and share his, and he named it as a successes and setbacks. And he came with such a learning experience. This was a super hit in our webinar series, where there was an attendance of over 450. So that was a fine learning experience for all the youngsters and even for the seniors. My lords, this is another USP where the entire, this session was heralded by Pushya Sitaraman, senior advocate, and 10 women, empowered women, gave a joined together and gave a wonderful session on various assessments and various acts. This was a new initiative with it. My lords, this is also very exclusive. We tried to give, instead of a drama, instead of a normal lecture, we made a drama. It was the first of its kind in the whole of the webinar world. I have not seen, or I have not heard even rather, a webinar being conducted by a drama where around 17, 18 participants acted and tried to communicate a message on the construction industry. And it was very well received with 250 participants. It was conceived like as if there was a buyer going to buy a flat after his marriage, and what are all the legal consequences, impediments, everything was captured in a very novel way. And this was a super hit, one of a super hit in MTB's, my lords. Then we had a very, very important session where on 4 very important topics of law, equity, double jeopardy, judicial review, and sub silentio. 4 great speakers and came and gave a discussion where from the genesis of those laws, it was tried. I mean, it was researched and explained to me lots. Then this is another very important milestone for us, where we were invited. Madras Tax Bar was invited by All Bengal Tax Bar Association to Calcutta. Three speakers, three very important speakers of us, Lordship knows, T.R. Sandal Kumar, A.P. Srinivas, and Swaminathan, all standing councils for the department were invited from the Madras Tax Bar, went there and gave a fantastic, and the reviews are amazing, the lots, that our pride was exported from Chennai to Calcutta. That was a very proud moment for us. Last but not the least, my lots, we also conducted, because this is a profession which we live, we eat, and we pray. And so we, on GST Day, which was 1st of July, just 3 days before, we conducted a webinar in celebrating the third GST Day. 1/7/2017 was the inception. So 1/7/2020, we conducted and we paid a tribute. And we also analyzed where none other than, Vasa Seshagiri Rao, Principal Chief Commissioner, who retired a day before he came. Then Vaitheeshwaran was there. And with the AP Srinivas and Aparna Nandakumar, it was a fine panel discussion, my lords. With this, I close this. And now, let me complete the last slide, my lords. After completing 99, with so much of stars coming in, we thought there was so much of hue and cry, so much of expectation. What should be for the 100? Because we have given so many super hits over the period, that what is the only thing which can make a fitting, or what is everyone was debating. And we had the privilege and the honor of none other than the superstar himself coming and speaking for Madras Tax Bar as an exclusive session for our 100. Welcome you, my lords. With folded hands, I welcome you to the session and hand over the baton to Mr. Pramod or Prithvi to take it forward. Thank you, my lords. Much obliged.
Thank you very much, JK, sir. 100 webinars in 5 minutes. You have summed it up so beautifully. Now I call upon Mr. Pramod Chopra to kindly give his welcome speech and welcome our speaker for the day, Dr. Justice Vineet Kothari.
Thank you, Prithvi. Good evening. Thanks, JK, for going through, highlighting our 100 webinars series to all the participants, and in particular to our Justice Vineet Kothari ji. I welcome Honorable Dr. Justice Vineet Kothari ji, Honorable Judges of Madras High Court and other courts, Honorable Members of various tax tribunals, Council for Central and State Government, authorities from various tax departments, my colleagues from legal fraternity, professionals from chartered accountants, secretaryships, and brothers and sisters. I deem it to be my proud privilege to introduce our esteemed guest and today's speaker, Honorable Dr. Justice Vineet Kothari ji, to this august participant, which at present stands at 163 numbers. Born on 2nd September 1959 at Jodhpur, Rajasthan, Dr. Vineet Kothari ji did his schooling and college at Jodhpur. While completing his law graduation in 1981, he also qualified as a chartered accountant and company secretaryship. After practicing as a chartered accountant for a few years, his lordship enrolled as advocate on 7th September 84 and started his practice in Rajasthan High Court, focusing on tax laws. During this period, he was also a part-time lecturer at Jodhpur Law College and LLM in 1999 and PhD in tax laws in 2004. Friends, when Dr. Justice A.R. Lakshman was the Chief Justice of Rajasthan High Court in the year 2002, he called upon his lordship, who was only about 42 years of age at that time, to become the judge of the Rajasthan High Court. This turned out to be a starting point, and his lordship elevated to bench of Rajasthan High Court on 13 June 2005. After rendering his service for 11 years, For about 11 years in Rajasthan High Court, his lordship was transferred to Karnataka in April 2016 and thereafter to Madras High Court on 23rd November 2018 as senior judge. His lordship was also also the acting chief justice, was also acted as the acting chief justice of Madras High Court from September 2019 to November 2019. His lordship is the executive chairman of TNS LSA, Legal Service Authority, and is a part of various important committee of Madras High Court. Dr. Kothari ji was also chief editor of CHS Literature, a law journal on indirect taxes during the relevant time, that during that period, published from Jodhpur between 1986 and 1990, and has written several articles on tax law and other subjects. One of his articles on child education and elevation of poverty in India, in which he gave a suggestion for compulsory military training to the youth of the country, which was acknowledged and appreciated by the then President of India, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. His paper on constitutional features and Indian democracy was published in 2013 by Korea Legal Research Institute in their global issue. Justice Kothari ji has participated in several conferences, including some of the international conferences, and has contributed papers on international taxation and other allied subjects at Amsterdam, Madrid, Switzerland, Helsinki, and Brisbane. He is an honorary board member of International Association of Tax Judges and a member of Commonwealth Magistrate and Judges London. His lordship has rendered various landmark judgments in all fields of law, and many of them are followed by various high courts and also approved by the apex court. The total number of cases decided by Justice Kothari ji in past 15 years as judge of three high courts are around 45,000, which does not include bail matters. Justice Kothari ji belongs to a family of chartered accountants and lawyers, and his elder brother, Sri B.M. Kothari ji, was an eminent chartered accountant in Rajasthan, and he served the Income Tax Appellate Tribunal with great distinction for about 15 years. After his demise, the public road adjacent to their home at Sardarpura, Jodhpur, was named after him as B.M. Kothari Road by Municipal Corporation, Jodhpur. Justice Kothari ji is happily married to Mrs. Meena Kothari, an advocate and a trained mediator. His elder son, Mr. Vinay, is a practicing lawyer at Jodhpur, and married and blessed with two daughters. Justice Kothari's younger son, Mr. Mehul, did his LLM from Erasmus University, Rotterdam, and practicing at Jodhpur. Justice Kothari ji is spiritually devoted and is passionate about sports and like to play table tennis, badminton, and cricket. He is also interested in soft music, particularly instrument music. My Lord was at his candid best in his talk in coffee bar, where amongst other things, he played the flute. Ladies and gentlemen, we could not have hit the century in a better way than having his lordship amidst us as the speaker who has been heading tax portfolio amongst others in Madras High Court since his joining at Madras High Court. I once again welcome his lordship, Dr. Justice Vinit Kothari ji, and request him to deliver his talk on simplification of tax laws in the 100th webinar of Madras Tax Bar webinar series. Thank you. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Am I audible? I've unmuted myself.
Yes, sir.
Vanakkam and very good evening to all you friends. It's a great pleasure and honor to be with you before the courts start regular functioning on 6th. And it's a matter of privilege and proud, I would say, to ask the night watchmen to come and run the 100th run. But the credit goes to those who have made 99, not to the person who runs the last leg of century. So it's like that. But since I have been a cricketer also, and therefore in that cricket language, I have to do my rather easy job of completing the 100th run, which of course Madras Tax Bar deserves kudos and congratulations for doing so wonderful. Mr. JK, who was taking us through the 100 webinars in a capsule form in 5 minutes, I could see a wonderful comprehensive picture of the areas and subjects and topics which you have covered. And I wish that if I had attended even 50% of that, I would have passed my exam with distinction. And wonderfully, all learned senior advocates and judges have covered almost all aspects of not only tax laws, but life as such. And I'm very happy to be part of this series of 100 webinars. And most of the learned advocates who are in the audience today have been my friends and have appeared in my court, so I know them personally. They are very, very competent lawyers, all of them, including one I can see, Mr. Manu Mudgal from Delhi, my friend, is on my screen. And from him, I have learned thinking also. Thank you for all this. And the tagline of this Madras Tax Bar is also wonderfully well designed. Not only the backgrounds of the flyers which you made, I was seeing there should be definitely a team of artists also with you people. Tax people are generally not known to be artists, but there should be some brains. Definitely, you develop the backgrounds of the flyers which you just now showed, and socially distanced, which is the rule today, and intellectually connected, which cannot, nobody can bar. So very good. And intellectually connected, if a big group of eminent people and lawyers like Madras Tax Bar remain positively connected, I think we can create wonders. And today's theme, which I am going to just touch in my own manner, humble manner, is the simplification of laws. So if we people can contribute to the simplification of law, we can create really wonders. Friends, first of all, I would like to make a kind of disclaimer that though I am a sitting judge, but the opinions expressed today may not be taken as opinions expressed authoritatively in a court of law, because we are in a webinar, which is rather informal. And Tax Bar, since it is my family, friends and family members, for whatever I say is not the considered opinion of the court. Sometimes I may be given a off-the-cuff remark also. Therefore, it's not authoritative pronouncement as such, because there we work with the great assistance of you competent people, and then we turn out good judgments will come if the good assistance is there. Bad judgments can come if bad assistance is there, as you all know. So now, turning slightly towards the theme of the topic today, simplification of tax laws. I think I would touch both direct taxes and indirect taxes in this topic, which I find to be of greater interest to our community as legal fraternity and also as citizens. Because as we all know, tax is a very, very important source of revenue for the government. And revenue is very essential. It's the lifeblood or the very food of the economy. Therefore, the tax laws have to be have their own importance, no doubt about that. But what has happened over past since 1922, the Income Tax Act is there, even before independence. And after independence, 1961 Act came, which is going through all through these times. And we had a talk of direct tax code in between, which is also in embryonic situation even now. And the talk of simplification is also not a new thing. It has been going on ever since the act itself was made. But what I have felt as a person dealing with tax law since my lawyering days or practicing days is that the practice of amending the Income Tax Act, let me talk first about the Income Tax Act, every year with the finance bills and finance acts is not a really very happy exercise. To reflect the monetary and economic policies of the government of the day through the Income Tax Act, in my humble opinion, may not be a very good legislative practice. So what we are trying to discuss today through question and answer session and even my speech is more about the legislative practices involved in the tax laws. Because simplification can happen only if the parliament or the state legislatures want it. We as lawyers, as judges, cannot do that, because our job is to interpret what is existing on the statute book. So the simplification procedure can happen since only through legislative bodies. Our inputs in these kind of seminars or conferences can be only helpful, or inputs to the legislative wisdom, as I call it, for them to seriously consider and, if possible, adopt those practices so that simplification happens. As we all should know, that simplification will definitely result in better compliance, and better compliance and possibly more revenue. and less litigation. To us, less litigation is also equally important. Therefore, these things can happen if the tax laws, which are in our country rather ill-famous of being very complex and complicated, can happen if only the multiple amendments which are effected in the main enactment is not done in this manner. Therefore, I have a suggestion which you all as august body should consider. It's just a suggestion as a lawyer inside me, or as a citizen, or as a person knowing bit of tax laws, that the government of the day, which is in our democratic setup, is likely to have a period of about 5 years, should have a package of schemes. Even if they announce for every year or for a period of 5 years, independent of the amendments to the Income Tax Act, those schemes can reflect their thought process or their desire to drive the economy through the motor of tax laws, if I can use that word. The same suggestion I gave in recent past in one of the webinars organized by the Institute of Chartered Accountants of India on their annual day on 1st July itself, that was held on 30th August, and one webinar which IFA conducted with Harish Salve and me on the board, also I gave this suggestion. Now, this is a very out-of-box kind of thinking, that if the government can give a shape to the monetary and economic policies, not by amending the tax laws, but by schemes promulgated by them in the parliament, which should be debated thoroughly, and debated outside the parliament also with the tax forums like associations and industry and tax consultants, etc., can be done. That will not only have an independent implementation exercise, which will be of course done by the same executives which are implementing the income tax laws and other laws, but not amending the parent act will save it from being, I can use the term, mutilated by the constant amendment procedure. This constant amendment, even I was going through some, because I am a fan of Mr. Palkhivala, some books and some excerpts which I'll perhaps some extracts I'll read to you also. He lamented during those days in his famous budget speeches after the budgets were announced, that the constantly amendment of the Income Tax Act leaves much to be desired. We tax people in courts and outside, when we give consultation to our friends, we know very well that the kind of subsections, kind of provisos, kind of explanations, kind of multiple not non-obstantive provisions are there in the Act. By the time you read subsection 1 and you read subsection 10 and then explanations and provisos, you forget what was subsection 1. So this tragedy or comedy of errors, if I can use in a lighter way, has to be given a serious thought. Now, we really don't forget, but the confusion arising from these kind of multiple complex provisions which are amended constantly, some deletions, some insertions, some even retrospective insertions, leaves the job of the consultants, what to talk of the poor litigants and the assessees and the taxpayers, in absolute quandary. And therefore, the first step I thought, after giving a thought to the whole process, how to really go for this simplification, I thought that the legislative practice has to be slightly modified, or rather not slightly, it has to be modified drastically, I would say. Now, if I just were to give you an example of the kind of mathematical number of the provisions, which are not mathematically numbered, but A, B, C, D, B, C, D, A, CA 58, BC, etc. The kind of numbers we have in the various chapters of the income tax is mind-boggling. I will just give you some examples. Let us have a first look at the TDS provisions. I have the book with me. You all know it very well. I want to drive my point home, and therefore I'm telling you. Chapter 17 talks of collection and recovery of taxes. Section 190 and 191 is general, but then 190 2 onwards, part B of this chapter commences about the deduction of tax at source. Now it has 192, 192 capital A, then 194, 194 capital A, B, B, C, E, etc. Series goes on. Then 194N it ends, 194O, then 195, etc. Like this, even if you go to chapter 6A, deductions, so many AT sections are there. ATC, ATE, ATA, ATAA, BB, etc., etc. Now this whole scheme, which is don't want to bother you with the mathematical, nor I want to threaten you with these kind of numbers. But the whole purpose of giving that benefit is, in my humble opinion, frustrated or rather defeated because you have to read all provisions in a contextual manner. Why this scheme was enacted? What is the real benefit intended to be given? How the TDS for that particular payment which a person makes has to be made? Whether it's a corporate body, who is the recipient, whether it is individual, HUF, the different shapes of factors which go into making of a particular provision and constant amending procedures makes it very complex. A simple provision, like a person making a payment which is taxable as income in the hands of the recipient, will be liable to deduct the flat rate of tax, say 30%, 20%, whatever you want to provide, could have been provided. And the very purpose of making these tedious provisions is the advance and timely collection of taxes and deposit the same with the treasury. That is the purpose. That purpose can be best achieved by task responsibility, which is even today now there, on the person making a payment which is taxable as income, as defined in the Act, liable to deduct the tax and put it to the government. The whole process can be done away with. Why do you have to classify the nature of payment? Why do you have to classify the nature of person making the payment? Why do you have to classify the nature of person receiving the payment? All this is unnecessary. So that what I want to drive home is that these multiple thoughts or the processes or the schemes which are sought to be incorporated in the Income Tax Act every year to reflect the thinking of the government of the day, which changes every 5 years and sometimes lesser than that, can be done. Come to deductions parts, come to exemptions of Section 10, multiple schemes, multiple sections, multiple object is one. You want to give incentive to the assessor. Now, can it not be done that once you are assessed, if you are found to be falling in a particular category, a particular type of industry, a particular type of SSE, particularly locations like SEZ and all these things, the assessing authority will be bound to reduce your taxable income by 30%, 40%, 10%, 20%, whatever you want to say. You claim, you file evidence, you prove. That proof itself becomes subject matter of litigation up to Supreme Court. And then you finally get or don't get or partly get is the process. This can be left to the assessing authority, which I'll later on or perhaps now also I can give. Now, to avoid the whims of particular person acting as a single team, I want to suggest that a committee of officers should work as a single team. Now, of course, the reforms which the department is taking now these days are faceless assessments. You don't have to meet your assessing authority. You don't have to even know him. The queries will come by emails. You have to reply by emails. You have to upload your evidence and documents. It has reduced substantially the interactive things which happened and which created in all these unnecessary high-pitched assessments and then litigation and then appeals and revisions and all that. This can be reduced. If a committee of persons makes an assessment, the chances of taking a particular pro-revenue or pro-SSE view for any particular point can be substantially reduced because there will be a fair debate in that committee against or before whom a team or an individual counsel or consultant appears virtually or physically, whatever. This can be done. Now, simplification of procedures is also equally important as important is the simplification of the substantive provisions of the tax laws. Now, slightly digressing, I would take you to the topic of international taxation. That has been my favorite subject also, and since I had the privilege and benefit of representing the country in some international conferences, in the, being a member of International of Tax Judges, as Mr. Chopra told. The treaties, DTAs, the Double Taxation Avoidance Reliefs Agreements, treaties they are popularly known, has also given rise to so many questions of interpretation. And international taxation has, as you all know, the impact on the other countries, other sovereign countries, with whom you have to have political diplomacy and economic relationship. So your tax laws, your provisions in the treaties have to be clearly understood, not only by your country, by the other countries also. Now, this treaty framing takes place as of today in the realm of the executive. The Income Tax Department or the Finance Ministry, a team of people there, some of them have been my friends also, I know them, and therefore I've interacted with them also, is done by executive. Now, the wisdom of the legislation does not go into it. There is no prior consultation. There is no prior debate. Now, there is no big secret about framing of the DTAs. You are bound by various compelling circumstances and factors of the international taxation, which are being adopted by other countries also, like GAAR, like safe harbor rules, like transfer pricing norms, OECD norms, agreements, model treaties. So many things happen. Now in India, now India is to become a superpower, we all pray and guess. Now you are a big power, you are a big economy, you are a big market. Your treaties, Mauritius treaty, we all know, resulted in what? Vodafone, retrospective amendment, huge debate, huge international arbitration. This could have been avoided very well if the treaties are debated in public domain before you enter. After all, you represent a country, a democracy, a big sovereign. Therefore, this debate in parliament floor, in my understanding, can simplify the root or basis of the international taxation to a very large extent. So, suggestion number two. So, these suggestions which I am going to address this learned audience today is more about the legislative practices, able draftsmanship, good draftsmanship. So the confusion and the legal debates in the courts of law happens largely because of the bad draftsmanship. And then twisted arguments of great lawyers. Why it should happen? If a thing is as simple as that, as simple as can be understood in a layman's language or with little bit of orientation towards tax, you can very well get your relief or get your claim sanctioned or sanctified or assessed. So therefore, these good draftsmanship as the root is at the root of the simplification, both in the substantive law of direct taxes. It can be either Income Tax Act or whatever, Wealth Tax Act, fortunately, is not much of significance now. Income tax is the main law. Now, I come to the third aspect of penal provisions. Again, you find the same difficulty of so many nature of penalties, 271C, CCE, etc., etc. Can you not simply say default or offense as defined elsewhere in that chapter will be punishable with fine and imprisonment of these graded nature? Imprisonment can be more, commencing from 6 months to 6 years, or depending upon the severity of the offense. And fine can also be related to the tax sought to be evaded. Now, one penalty provision can serve the cause. One prosecution provision can serve the cause. Why do you need to have so many provisions? This happens because every year you come out with different kinds of offenses, different kinds of penalties, different kinds of defaults and offenses defined in your act. If the substantive provisions of the Act contains the relevant provisions with ample clarity. One provision can deal with penalty and prosecutions. This is another aspect of the matter which I think the industry, the tax bodies, the tax professionals should really debate and keep their members, parliament, friends in confidence, call them in those debates, tell them to debate this on the floor of the parliaments and then do it something about it. As we said, we lawyers and judges can't make the laws. We have to only interpret the laws. Therefore, the job lies elsewhere. But yes, our expertise, our wisdom, if it is at all there, then can be used by those people also very well. So this is another aspect of the matter. Now, about retrospective legislation, I want to say a few words. Retrospective legislation should be, in my understanding, avoided as far as possible. Because it puts upon the taxpayer a liability which he could not envisage at the contemporary point of time or period of time. So therefore, retrospective legislation can be avoided as far as possible. It's not very necessary. Now, what has happened, unfortunately, is that most of the amendments are brought in to undo the judgments of the high courts and Supreme Courts. There is another debate possible on that. Now, the well-settled principles of that amendment, in my understanding, are that if the court strikes down a legislation or a provision, pointing out certain defect in law, that because of this defect, this particular provision cannot be sustained on the constitutional parameters, and therefore it deserves to be struck down, the course open to the legislature is to remove that defect, patch up that defect, and then make that amendment. Legislature has the power to undo the judgment. There is no insult involved in that. But there is a procedure known to law for doing that. Unfortunately, that procedure, that well-settled principle of amending somewhere has been lost. And for that, my suggestion to the legislators is, you know, the amendment to the bills or finance act or whatever main substantive law, statement of objects is also always there. In such cases of amendments where you have to undo the judgment, the statement of bill should clearly specify and stipulate what was the defect pointed out by the court, which resulted in its striking down, how the legislature intends to fill it up, and therefore, what is the need of the amendment? How much revenue has been lost because of that judgment? Unless these figures and data are discussed and need of retrospective or prospective amendment is discussed to undo a judgment, in my humble understanding, that legislative practice is not a very fair practice because it puts on the shoulders of taxpayers a liability which they could not envisage at the contemporary period of time. Now, as you all know, retrospectively, the most discussed thing happened in Vodafone's case. Section 9 was amended to undo the Supreme Court judgment. And then the hue and cry arose, and then the matter is now in international arbitration and there is pending there. And the litigation is also pending in some courts on different issues, of course. But then, had the Section 9 been comprehensively interpreted, a comment which I ventured to make, not as a judge again, I would say, that was not necessary. The existing provisions of Section 9 could tax that income if it was properly done. If the treaty had been clear, if the Mauritius Treaty did not contain the loopholes which it did, and benefit for state. Now, these are some thoughts. I'm not to debate on a particular case. While touching the point of retrospective amendment in tax laws, I'm referring to this. The third aspect, which in my understanding, I can give to you and I can discuss with a audience of learned people like you, is the simplification of the procedures. Not only the Before I do that, let me touch briefly the GST part of indirect taxation, which is now, as you know, 14 taxes have been subsumed and indirect tax, one nation, one tax, GST has come from 1st July 2017 and you held a beautiful webinars on that also. Now, GST, in my understanding, again, I'm not to criticize all the aspects because GST is a concept I love and I appreciate that concept very much. And multiple taxation, multiple forums, multiple procedures have been done away with. Very good. Congratulations to the government for that. But the GST as a concept was envisaged to be one tax on one type of indirect tax on goods and services at multiple points of sales and services rendered, with the input tax credit given credit to remove the cascading effect, as we all know. Now, this tax was really intended to be one tax, one rate. Maybe one rate in a big country and with a country like India with different nature of trades and commodities involved could not have been perhaps implemented immediately, because this implementation of law has suffered because of the technology support not being fully prepared perhaps for that. Therefore, the e-passes and e-filing of returns and invoices, etc., gave several problems which you must have discussed in those webinars. But the intention of was to avoid the various taxation. Now this GST, long ago in my STL thing, I had written an article about 30 years back, uniform rate of tax on various commodities. And let the trade, demand and supply decide the flow of the trade. Now, this could have been this this concept of uniform rate of taxation would have not only avoided the huge litigation on the interpretation of the commodity taxation itself, which commodity will fall in which entity and taxable at what rate, is a huge commodity litigation, which I have been rather beneficiary as a lawyer while I was practicing last night. I could have compiled one digest, which I'll. This was my first academic achievement, if I can say so. Of STL yearly digest. So this was done. Now, I was talking about that uniform rate of taxation. Now, this is the at the basis of the VAT law, which came much later, and GST now law also. Now, if you can't maintain one rate taxation, which is ideally available in some of the developed countries like perhaps Germany or Australia has one rate, you can have five categories, say exempted, essentials, foods, etc., you exempt them. 5% general commodities, which are which has a large trade volume. 10%, 25% on luxury goods. Now, if the minimum slabs are maintained and one law can be maintained for being implemented, after all, you are a federal character, you are a federal democracy. Now, this enactment of the IGST and SGST law separately, and CST kept for six commodities, as we know, and I've given a judgment on that also, happened because more of political reasons. The political parties could not come to a consensus of having one law throughout the country. And that is why it happened. Now, had it not happened, imagine the simplification of the GST law itself. One law, different authorities or one department throughout the country, implementing that, it could be either sales tax department, VAT department, or excise department, or a combination of them, no problem. But they could have solved this problem. But certain things do not happen for different reasons. We can't control that. But conceptually speaking, I would still say, and now the debates would also show that they are trying to reduce the slabs, and gradually they evolved object of one rate. And one law they are never talking, but can be done in my understanding. Now coming to the procedural simplification. I would humbly submit in a very brief manner, because this may have the aspects which touches all of us as lawyers and taxpayers and tax consultants and chartered accountants and tax practitioners. The procedural simplification is necessary from the angle of the taxpayers. Now, taxpayers, if the laws are simple, can very well understand and comply the tax laws on their own, whether it is GST or income tax. But because that is not simple, they have to engage consultants at every step. You can't file even your simple GST return or income tax return on your own. Can you? Possibly not. Why? This is the first stage, filing of return. The moment a assessment notice comes, the SAC starts sweating. Why it should happen? If the procedures are simple, you have to just explain few queries of your tax gatherer or tax collector. You can explain that. But it does not happen in practice. Therefore, procedural simplicity or simplification is also equally important. Let me touch the aspect of multiple tiers of remedial measures provided in our tax laws also at the same time. I have written an article on that also. Unfortunately, we don't have the confidence in our tax collectors at the basic level. No assessment order is allowed to go, perhaps, without the first appeal, second appeal, writ petition, or second appeal in the Constitutional Court, 260A. Now, why it should happen? And then you can't blame the system for taking very long to decide. You don't have the infrastructure or the sufficient strength to decide the appeals. You provide for provision, no stay, tribunal can't grant the stay beyond 6 months, but you can't decide the appeal by tribunal in 6 years. Whom to blame? Has there been any analysis of output by the officers, by the tribunal members, even by the judges? Why one should feel shy of being analyzed and discussed about the efficiency and outputs? These all things are, if you think boldly, and out of box. Now, you can keep on talking about simplification of tax laws and do nothing about it. You're not going to solve the problem. You are only enjoying the webinars, that's all. But then this is not the ideal situation. Ideal situation is better compliance, better revenue, and then better accountability on the part of the government. The collection, on the old times, somebody said that tax should be collected like the honeybees collect the honey from the nectar. It should be as painless as that, as simple as that. Now, these words of wisdom, I think we should not lose hope. We should be able to guide or rather prompt our legislators for this. Now, how bad procedures can result in what complications? I would like to quote one paragraph from the Palkiwala's book, which coffee table book I have with me. It was written by my friend Mr. Bhandari, Dharmendra Bhandari from Bombay, chartered accountant. The beautiful book of about the personal life of the Palkiwala, including his extract from the famous budget speeches, of which we all must have been fans somewhere. He said about this, I'll read the lines. A system of law is growing up in this country with more and more powers conferred on the government officers, which can only be described in the words of Lord Hibbert as the new despotism, and which creates in the world of A.P. Hubbard a despotic executive. It is difficult to come across any new piece of legislation which does not leave decisions of the most far-reaching effect from the viewpoint of the individual to the government, which often in the practice means a not very highly placed administrative officer. The wide room of the harassment and corruption which such a legal system provides needs no underlining. The regimentation of a nation's life by executive action is not peculiar to this country. It is going all over the world, but the mischief is imponderably greater in a country like India, where the masses are illiterate, unconscious of their civil rights, and public opinion is not mobilized or educated. Though Mr. Palkiwala talked of the general executive government officers or bureaucrats in this paragraph, but it equally applies to the tax collectors also. Now, another extract which I have flagged for you people when I was preparing my webinar is like this. Calder had said that income tax, wealth tax, and expenditure tax between themselves should not exceed 100% of the income. One would have expected some relaxation in the expenditure tax or alternatively reduction in the rates of income tax and wealth tax. But on the contrary, in the new budget, where this was the those days I was talking 97%, fortunately we don't have those days now, whereas the income tax rate remains the same, the wealth tax rates have been made much more drastic. Looking at the provisions of the expenditure tax, one would think that to spend your own money is the greatest anti-social offense you could commit. Formerly, the state looked with disfavor on citizens who spent other people's money. Now it looks with disfavor on those who spend their own. This was in lighter vein, which Palkhivala said. And while defining inflation also, he was a very great witty person, as we all know. In 1973-74 budget, he was giving his budget speech. So he defined the inflation like this. The best definition of inflation is the simplest. When government spends more than it gets, the labor gets more than it gives, the empty feeling in your pocket is inflation. See the contrast. When the government spends more than it gets, so you have to print money, labor gets more than it gives, more than productivity, the empty feeling, the difference between the two in your pocket is the inflation. Now, how sarcastic it may be, how pinching it may be, how pointed it can be, but how true it can be is for everybody to know. So these are the points. I can go on with this also, but I think we should not take very long. But these are the points which we as lawyers and as tax experts and as responsible citizens. When I talk of responsible citizen, I should talk about the justice delivery system also. I have been feeling friends for quite long, and wherever possible, I've expressed this opinion also, that the delays caused in courts and even in the tribunals these days happens majorly because of the lack of infrastructure. The size simply does not fit in. If the number of judges, number of courts is very less, and you put a lot of burden on them, why do you expect a magic from the human mortals? You should not. Today we all know 70% of the litigation is by or against the government. Does it not pain anybody of us? Does somebody not consider it? Now you come out with these schemes of withdrawal of these appeals. All these tax lawyers, department lawyers would know how easily we dispose of those, happily dispose of those cases. But that doesn't give us satisfaction. That is no way of reducing the litigation. Why it should arise in the first instance should be the question. It happens because of the commission or omission on the part of the tax collectors, tax gatherers. Why it should happen? Because probably we are not properly trained them. They are allowed to take whimsical views. They are allowed to raise high-pitched assessments, leaving the assessors to fend for themselves. There is no accountability concept with them. Somebody cannot check their activities. Is it not part of the society, as a civil society, as a body responsible, that we should discuss and debate these things also? We should. Why should we leave it to others? If you don't do things in your times, you should not blame your next generation. Now, how to do it? How to do simplification of the procedures? How to do simplification of the bureaucracy? How to do simplification or corruption-free executive? I think the things have to start with primary education in the country. We are not creating responsible citizens in our country. We are turning out employable, unemployed youth in our country. Nobody really feels to be belonging to this country. Everybody wants a job. Everybody wants reservation. Everybody wants to make both ends meet. That's all. I'm sorry if I'm swayed away. But unless we create good citizens, how do you create good lawyers? How do you create good bureaucrats? And how do you create good legislators? You should be first taught to love your country, love your society, love yourself. So unless we do this, beginning with the education, beginning with the good training, beginning with the good accountability, possibly all these talks will remain very hollow. The purpose of my telling you all this is just to awaken, just to prompt, just to arouse you. Whatever little manner I can do, I try to match my acts with my words. But that one person alone can't do anything and everything. We as a community, we should do it. So with these few words, brothers and sisters, I think I should rest my long speech, which could be treated as by some as sometimes as emotional outbursts also. But I didn't mean that at all to be outbursts. I want to take you all to take them as some meaningful words and do at your own level whatever you can do to all these things which we are talking. So simplification is not that simple. It's very difficult. The path to simplification is very difficult. The object is very high, but it is achievable. If you can go up to the Mount Everest, why can't you go to the simplification of tax laws? It's not that difficult after all. And JK, before I end, I must congratulate you for the beautiful background which you have, the black and white and red combination which you have in your background appear to be very, very, very wonderful and impressive. And you introduce your webinars very nicely. And congratulations and thanks for that. I hope I have not bored you, friends. And with that, I'll give it to the Prithvi for some question answers, if I can be of some further discussion in that. Thank you very much.
Malod, I'm sure that we would have definitely loved to hear more from you because the speech was so wonderful and it was so connecting. So thank you once again, Malod, for that wonderful talk. We do have a few questions from our participants. Yes. First, I would unmute Mr. Raghavan Ramabhadran.
Yes, please.
Raghavan, sir.
Good evening, Lord Trips. Lord Trips,
yes. Yeah, Raghavan.
Lord Trips, yes. Lord Trip, I have 2 points I want to know. One, I would like to invite your Lord Trip's comment on that. I have 2 points to Lord Trip. On the first one, I will not invite your Lord Trip's to comment, but on the second one, I would request your Lord Trip. Talking of pending litigation, your Lord Trip, while assessees try to avoid taxes, I don't mean evade taxes, they avoid taxes. At the same time, our Lord Trip, also the tax officers being given a target to achieve in terms of issuing orders, etc. Lord Trip, in my humble opinion, Lord Trip, that also adds to a lot of unnecessary litigation. But I feel it may not be appropriate for me to invite your Lord Trip's views on this point. But on the second point, which I wish to seek your Lordship's views, is when it comes to legislative drafting, Lordship very rightly pointed out on the importance of legislative drafting.
But your voice is cracking. Can you repeat?
We had a very great opportunity.
Second point again.
I'm talking about legislative drafting. Yeah, yes. The second drafting point is about legislative drafting. Legislative drafting, yes. Lordship. Insofar as indirect tax is concerned, we had a brilliant opportunity now in form of GST, where it subsumed so many indirect taxes and many things could have been done in making a law very simple, which the government earnestly attempted also. But even with respect to the transition provision itself, we had so many litigations, so many interpretations revolving around Lordship. From what we also experienced, there are going to be so many problems relating to ITC. And I mean input tax credit. And also I feel, your Lordship, many things have already been settled, but those settled decisions have not been used in the process of drafting. Lordships feel that if some eminent lawyers successful in this practice are also involved in legislative drafting, would it help in evolving a simple tax lawyer?
Yes, yes. I touched that point briefly. Thank you for the question, Raghavan. It is very important. Not only in the lighter vein, I would say, while this gap gives you your bread and butter between the complications and simplifications, but you are very right that the eminent lawyers or the experts of the field who do this long interpretative exercise in the courts of law should be made part of the drafting stage itself. So that is why the need to have the public debates on the various bills to amend the law should take place even at these forums. They take place as of now, but more as a formality. There should be a longer period. There should be advance notice, sufficient debate, sufficient spreading of the bill, etc. And then you debate them. And that is very necessary. In lighter veins, once I think I had observed in the court, I wish I would have been a draftsman rather than a judge. After seeing so many complicated provisions one after the other, I would have perhaps better drafted that provision.
So, why, that is, in fact, why not your lordship? Lordship in your next stint can be that also.
No, even if you go to law commission, you know where the reports are kept, you know very well. So it is very good that a legislative practice develops, that a public debate with the lawyers and taxpayers, industry and concerned ministers and bureaucracy takes place. That would help. A good drafting is at the bottom of everything. And therefore, I think it's a very good suggestion. And now, you know, government has taken some horizontal entries of the experts from the industry in their bureaucracy also, though in a very small measure. That could be increased, particularly in tax laws. If people like you people, two people from every state is taken in that committee and that goes to Delhi and debates it, or online also debates it. It's very good, worthwhile exercise. Yes. Thank you.
My lord, the next question I'll take from Mr. V.S. Jayakumar, sir. I'll unmute him.
Yeah.
Lord, this low tax circulars, as your lordship correctly said about instead of amending the Income Tax Act, go by certain schemes, you can outsource this, then least to tinker with the main act. I mean, that's a fantastic suggestion. But just to give an example, this Vivad Ke Vishwas scheme, it's actually a scheme, but it's not under the act. You see the conundrums with what your lordship suggested is practically not implemented for the day. Similarly, the low tax circulars, audit objection, that comes from where? I mean, these are all like chaotic situations and extremely difficult. The lordship may kindly enlighten on that.
I think, sir, schemes are also in that way subordinate legislations only, delegated legislations only. So good drafting is required even in that. Last days, when we were doing tax bench, I've been telling them all this, that you, why do you make these exceptions of audit objection and revisional and this 148 business in the withdrawal business? Either you want to fight in the court of law, you don't want to fight in the court of law. Then why these exceptions? So therefore, there is no good reason to make, these are spikes in the simple piece of circular, which could simply say revenue stake 1 crore or less as per assessment order, withdraw it, finish, matter ends. Why should you have exceptions in the exceptions? Withdrawal itself is an exception. So exception into exception is not at all a happy situation. And that is why you need good schemes like them are also failing. What about VDI's schemes? They put so many spikes in that SSC and tax consultants get confused whether to go for it or not to go for it. Then you keep on extending the time limit. That doesn't help. So simplification at all levels. And the main, I think we have already touched that point, is the drafting. One should, and there is a principle in Jainism also, anekantvar. Before they do something, they should look to that thing from different angles. How the taxpayer will look at it, how the tax revenue department will look at it, how the general public will look at it, how the tax consultant will look at it. If somebody examines it from different angles, I think the simplicity can come.
Lord, a limited by retrospectivity, is it not welcome? Retrospectivity from the inception may be bad. Limited retrospectivity, what is your view on that?
Sir, it can become necessary on some occasions. It can come. But then the legislature has to explain the reason for that very, very, very elaborately. The problem of non-compliance happens because of the lack of confidence. People do not understand it. People do not go for it. People do not like it or challenge it because they have not fully understood it. I would say it is a lack of communication. why bureaucracy and legislature cannot communicate properly with the people from whom they want the tax. So if it becomes necessary, you explain properly, you remove the defect pointed out by the court, say so in your statement of object that this was the defect, this is necessary to remove it like this, and this is how we intend to do it. Let there be a debate on that in the parliament. If the majority passes, it becomes a law. So it can be appreciated and tolerated only to a reasonable extent. You can't create a retrospective law from 1962 all the time to come.
Or 1944.
Yes.
Thank you.
For no fault of the SSCs. Yes, any other question, please?
Yes, sir. Malad, there are two, three more questions. Okay. Next, I will go to Mr. Ramesh, T. Ramesh, sir.
Okay.
Malad, I'll just unmute him.
Yeah. Ramesh, Mr. Ramesh, can you hear me?
Yes, Malad, sir. Yes, Malad. Just he unmuted me. Lord, okay. After 99 sessions or 99 runs of complicated provisions, 100th run lordship hit about the simplicity, which is the need of an hour, and declare the entire innings. We have to start a new innings. And we have to think about the new thinking about how to suggest about the simplicity of taxation law. It's a wonderful one. And it has been summed up by saying that, Lord, that it has to be, tax has to be levy or collected as honey bee sucks without damaging the flower. But this is a concept which I also, it was my first book in my GST book, which my wrapper thing is only this one. I put it that honey bee, which is, this is what my idea was also.
Now and people these days want only honey, forget the bees.
This is a wonderful sum up with regard to how to do the simplicity of law, especially the income tax law. And
it perhaps cannot be that simple, which I said with this quote, which I saw in some judgments, but then it can be much simpler. I mean, tax is a compulsory exaction, is also known. But then if you make it simple, make a compliance happy and willing and voluntary, then it can come to that theory as near as possible. But you can't make a complex law and then extract it out of a long process of complicated assessment and then take it. That is what is the departure.
Lord, thank you. For that broad, like GST, which subsumed various other laws, and for the past 3 years, there is no much of litigation as far as the GST is concerned. Mm-hmm. And as the tax practitioners, we also don't see the spate of litigation as we have seen with the excise customs or the service tax laws.
Yes.
Similarly, applying that one, as Lordship started with saying that instead of meddling with the already existing law, you should think about the new laws.
Yes.
On looking at the UK law, which I am a solicitor, where some occasions I had to look into.
Okay.
And when it is looked into, the UK has over a period of time has simplified the income tax law. So yes. But in line with that, why don't we introduce a new law as it is a GST law?
And when they talked of direct tax code, they almost repeated all the provisions of Income Tax Act there. That was necessary. That is what the tragedy of the direct tax code has been, and that is why it could not take off. And if you have to be simple, you have to depart at one point of time. And taking the same lot of the provisions from this book to that book will not solve the problem. And therefore, direct tax laws, if code at all has to come, it should come entirely new.
Really?
Learning from the debates which have been going on in the courts.
That is how simplification can be achieved. That is what
Yes, sir. That is why I said it is more about the legislative practices which the legislature has to undertake for simplification. Okay. And that should be the benefit which should accrue to them from these kind of debates. I can see Mr. Venkat Raman. Hello, good evening.
Yes, my lord, I'll unmute him next.
Unmute him. He's a senior counsel. So, how long you have been there, sir? I don't know.
Additional solicitor general now, my lord.
Okay. Congratulations for that. Yes.
Thank you. Take your best wishes, sir. Namaste. Sir, I want to say two things. The laws look very complex, but your speech was extremely simple, eloquent, and effective. We only wish the law is also as simple as that. We are very benefited by this talk because you could touch legislative amendments, delegated amendments, penalties, and international taxation diplomatic handling, and finally on the GST mechanism. It was a bouquet which I think definitely each one of us has benefited a lot. A lot of new angles have come to us for us to think also. And whatever the synergy, I'll just give you one example where we struggle. For example, we suggested some years back, as we have a composition tax in indirect tax, why don't we have a composition tax for direct taxes instead of going for deductions, incentives, and schemes? Yes. Let's pay like cross-border taxation, which is 10% or 20% based on three means. Let's pay 20% tax or 18% income tax on the total income. The answer which the ministry gave was, it will result in the loss of lakhs and lakhs of jobs for chartered accountants overnight.
Oh, no.
So, they said bookkeeping. So, I mean, or else, if
you... This was the official answer given by the ministry.
No, unofficial. Officially, unofficial. So, when they gave with this, when we said, why don't you give it in on a TDS basis? Why should we have so many incentives and schemes in the Act? This was the answer. So, the dynamics of the society also plays a role. I have one question to know your wisdom on that. Yes. We have combined 11, 12 laws in indirect tax, and we could arrive at a place called GST with both the union and states partnering together.
Yes.
Can that be a next step where indirect tax and direct tax can be integrated? And there is just one tax on total, instead of now the tax only on supply. Can there be a tax only on income? And can we move towards that direction? Is it possible? And what are your thoughts?
I think, sir, they are strange bedfellows. So they may not.
Oh, good.
But yes, because conceptually both are different. One, you can pass on the incidents; the other, you cannot pass on the incidents. That concept being different. I think let them first come to the simplification part, and then perhaps if we still aim higher, we can go for it. One tax, one flat rate, and you pay and you go off. Like in some foreign countries, they pay very less income tax, but they pay social security of your gross income. So, and then they're very happy because you are taken care in your old age throughout. Your food, shelter, and everything is taken care. So if the government can respond in that at that level, perhaps this dream can also be achieved. But in my lifetime, I don't see it. So maybe next life. Thank you very much.
Realistic and extremely effective talk and learning, sir. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Anybody else?
Quickly, my lord, we'll take up two, three more questions. Next from Maithili, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Yeah, Maithili. Yeah. Who's there?
My lord, it was an excellent 100th session. And here I just have a couple of observations and thoughts on this. If your lordship could throw some light on that.
Yes.
On one hand, talking about a new legislation per se, every time they either amend the law in the name of simplification or they create a new enactment, the complexity does not reduce, it seems to increase. And not only, and I think, is it not true that it is more about the way the tax is administered and the intention at every level that really drives the whole process? So if the intention is truly to simplify and not look at small, immediate effects, more, and often the knee-jerk response to the mounting litigation, the pendency of cases is bringing in things like a change in monetary limits or in maybe doing having a mandatory pre-deposit, or it could be something like the various amnesty schemes. Often all these changes seem to be encouraging tax evasion rather than tax compliance. And it's ultimately the honest taxpayer who seems to be suffering all this. And there is patent injustice in the way these amendments are brought about. I think, do they not have to take a relook at how they administer? And it all would boil down to the intention to do so. What is your view?
Very, very good observation, madam. But what I really feel as a taxman, the lesser number of factors for levy of taxation, like in one of the Supreme Court judgments, if you read that Govind Saran Ganga Saran's 1985, there are only four elements of a tax levy: object of taxation, rate of taxation, charging provision, and then procedure. If these four factors can be monitored closely and properly, the tax levy will always sustain. But unfortunately, the government of the day has spread these factors to so many areas that all these complications have happened. Now, you rightly said that instead of every year amending the same law and then making it more complicated, I think day has come where in 21st century, we can have entirely new income tax law. After debating these factors first threadbare thoroughly, that we want to have simple tax law on these premises, these parameters, these things. Revenue can be monitored after reporting for some time by manipulating these minimal factors. You increase the rate if you want more revenue. You reduce the rate if you want to give relief. So lesser number of factors monitored will give you better compliances, better revenues. And that was precisely my PhD subject in my tax laws. How simple economic models can get you better compliance and better tax revenue is the thing to be considered. So it's not impossible, as I said, but somebody has to be on the job, determined to do this. One can do it. It's a job of 10 wise people who think out of box to sit in the North Block and do it.
Yes.
Remaining 540 can just put a seal on that. Because law finally emanates only from those 10 people. How much debate you have seen in parliament which has changed the law? They only tinkered with law. So basic law has to emanate from meaningful expert people whose clarity of thought is unquestionable. That is what I want to say.
Thank you, Mulan. And digitization, and they can actually have a software to give that kind of a result. That can be developed, which can really simplify the whole process even further.
Yes, digitalization is the now norm. You have to go with it. And therefore, you have to adopt that, incorporate that into the system itself now.
Thank you, ma'am. Malaj, subject to your convenience, Malaj, we can...
One more, then give me 2 minutes. I want to take you on some lighter side.
Yes, Malaj, definitely. So we'll take up one more question, Malaj, and after that, we will move on to the next question. Malaj, the next question, I don't know who to choose. I'll ask Hema, ma'am.
If there is more demand, less supply, then you choose the best.
I have no one to select the best, Malaj, but I'll go with Hema, ma'am. Hema Murali Krishnan, ma'am.
Can you hear me properly, Hemaji?
This is with regard to our evergreen field of litigation. Evergreen field of litigation, 148 reassessment.
Yes.
Where the focus is only on change of opinion.
Now, we find that the assessing officer does not deal with all the disputes in the assessment order. Now, I also find that neither the high courts nor the Supreme Court have even a word or somewhere a line say advising all assessing officers that henceforth all of assessing officers will have to touch on all exemptions in the assessment order itself, failing which we will take strict action against the officers.
That is why I talked of two concepts. A committee of assessing authority to make them more responsible, and accountability and output of the officers.
If that is done, I think 148 itself, that litigation will come down to a very great extent.
So, you know, 148 is the major litigation in the courts of law.
No, but change of opinion is a very...
Being departmental counsel, madam, I will not allow you to change your opinion of... Yes, that's a lot of it. Very good. But 148, as you know, is the provision misused on both the sides. I mean, assessing of the side mostly. And that is why repetitions and appeals. Yes. So,
thank you.
Manoj,
my request, Manoj, one final question, Manoj.
Yes, okay, no problem.
Thank you, Manoj. Manoj, I'll unmute Mr. Natarajan.
Okay.
Yeah, good evening, Lordship. Yeah, good evening, Lordship.
Yes,
you rightly pointed out for the problem, the solution to all the problems lies in targeting the next generation. Because this generation, we can't do much about it. Catch the people young, educate them properly. So at least in the next generation, we will be free of all these problems. That is the message which we have taken today. So one particular thing which I would like to seek your Lordship's view was, see, there are the 90% of our citizens are compliant. They want to comply with the law. They want to respect the law. And there is always a 10% segment who wants to evade and who want to do all the mischief. The law should target the compliant person. The law should address the needs of the compliant person and it should help him to comply with the law. But unfortunately, what is happening is our laws are always targeting the 10% people who are evading. I can give so many examples. One example I will give. If you take this e-way bill mechanism under GST, you catch some vehicle, if the goods are non-duty paid, it's a clandestine removal, you collect the tax, you detain the vehicle, after paying the tax, you release it. This is what the provision says. But 90% of the cases which are booked on the road, it all deals with minor procedural issues. From Chennai to Delhi, instead of putting 2000 kilometer, I put 200 kilometer. They will ask me, they detain the vehicle. To get the release of the vehicle, I have to pay the tax once. Again, during my regular assessment, I have to pay the tax. So the problem lies in framing the law, not for the compliant assessees, but for the evaders. This approach, what is your take on your Lordship? Is it the right approach?
Yes, I understood your question, Natarajan. But the problem is not with the laws. Problem is with the implementation. You don't have the responsible good officers and clerks at the checkpost or whatever place you have. Why should they detain a goods if the 200 kilometers is mentioned in place of 2000 kilometers? Does a common man not know what is the difference between Delhi and Chennai? Can they not ignore it? Minimus de cruet lex. The unimportant, negligible things can be ignored. But since there is no accountability, if that goods are detained, truck is not released, and the loss ensues to the person concerned, nobody is there to reimburse him for that loss. Yes. So this happens because of they're not being good citizens. That is why I touched that point of you create good citizens. If they are good citizens, they will not think of this. And if the same man is paid 5,000 rupees, he will make that 2,000 in no time. So that is where the implementation part is wrong. Laws in that regard may not be that bad, but the implementation part, unfortunately, is there. And most of the things in our country happens bad because of the implementation, not because they are per se bad. Per se, they may be good, little less good or little more good, but implementation takes a severe beating. Yes, in courts also.
Thank you.
Yes. So
thank you.
This,
yes, my Lord.
Give me two minutes.
Yes, my Lord.
Friends, today a wonderful thing happened to me. Perhaps somebody attended my last webinar, which was discussing my, as a person, how Vineet Kothari is. And they said that you have interest in music. And therefore, I was having my flute on my table and I played it for 1 minute. And that perhaps gave an idea to some people in this webinar also. And in that webinar, I mentioned that I can pay a little bit of mouth organ also. So the friend there arranged to send a mouth organ to me, delivered to me today. So I must first thank him. And it's my duty to play it now. Yeah, Krishnananda. So thank you very much. And I will take it as honorarium paid for the webinar.
Absolutely. Not for
yes, madam. We would love to hear that.
At your choice, it is returnable also. No problem.
No problem. Not the issue is this. You started off by saying that you were a white batsman in the 100th webinar.
Okay.
You scored the last run and for victory. So now this playing of the Motar gun is a tribute to the victory and the last run hit by you.
Oh my God. Thank you very much. So friends, let me try, though it's after a long time that I'm trying. May not be that good. And please excuse me for that. But just to put a very burdensome topic like text to the resting place where it should be. For simplification, I'm trying. So thank you. And the song for 1 minute I play is the friendship between all of us. Hindi films. Yes. Chole, ye dosti hum nahi todenge.
Wow.
Chodenge
hum yes, Maharaj. Tera saath nahi todenge. Okay. Yes, Maharaj. Thank
you.
Wonderful.
That was a fitting finale, Milord.
Thank you very much. I really enjoyed being with all of you. And please excuse me if I have exceeded my limit, but as I claimed in disclaimer, that it is not as a judge, but as a friend, as a citizen, as a taxpayer. So thank you very much, Chopraji and all organizing members of the team. So 100 runs is completed and the match won, but the match continues. So IPL continues.
Definitely, Milord.
Thank you.
Milord, I would request Mr. APS, Mr. Srinivas, sir, to come and tell a few words and thereafter we conclude the session, Milord.
Okay.
Yes,
yes.
So on behalf APS, of Madras, yes, sir. On behalf of Madras Tax, we are immensely thanks to your lordship. And at the outset, so Lordship just wonderfully explained the concept of inflation, where many economists find difficult to explain. So Lordship beautifully explained the term inflation. And your Lordship's takeaway from today, your Lordship's session on simplification of tax laws is on the following, Lord. So first, by simplifying the taxation laws, the collection of tax will be increased only. So therefore, the department need not be worried. So this is the first quote by your Lordship. And it also, it avoids less, more dispute also, a lesser dispute only, it will come. Then the frequent amendments affect the taxpayer's mind and the complications in deductions provisions. And your Lordship touched upon the international taxation. Of course, it is one of your Lordship's favorite subject. And your Lordship delivered so many conferences in the international level. And your Lordship also suggested for amending the penal provisions. One penal provision would be enough to cover all the scenario, and the lesser imprisonment and prosecution also suggested. Then the retrospective amendment also, how it affects, particularly to overreach the judicial, which has been given to the SSE. Then our Lordship touched upon the simplification of procedures under, especially under GST. And of course, by suggesting a uniform rate, the classification dispute can be avoided. And your Lordship at the time given solution, Lordship address to the simplification of tax laws, also given solution at how it can be achieved. So all the stakeholders has to join together. First, your Lordship stressed upon the bureaucracy, and your Lordship said they should be accountable for their assessment orders. and the justice delivery system also should monitor that. So yeah, solution is also given by your lordships.
Okay.
I think and I think we all are benefited by your lordship session, Lord. And I hope many department officers and the chartered accountants and the various members of bar also present. I think they will rightfully take this lordship's advice, Lord. And I thank you, lordships, for spending your valuable time with us and for accepting our invitation and spending your valuable time with us, lordship. And I also thank Mr. N. Venkatraman, who has been recently appointed as additional Solicitor General for Supreme Court, and additional Advocate General, Mr. Narmada Sambath and Mr. S. R. Rajagopal, and various central government and state government officers, and members of our Madras Tax Bar and from various other bars, including All Bengal Tax Bar, and senior advocates, and Director General of Income Tax Investigation, Mr. D. C. Patwari, for Chennai Zone is with us, and ITAT Judicial Member, Mr. N. R. S. Ganesan is with us, Lord. And from various various members of various bar and chartered accountants and my friends, so I immensely thank all of you on behalf of Madras Tax Bar, and a special thanks to Lordship Justice Vinit Kothari. Thank you, Lordship.
Thank you very much. I'm so happy, so grateful to all of you, such a learned audience for the first time have assembled to listen to me, and I'm really grateful. Wish you all the best. Please keep safe health in these COVID times. Take good care of your health also, and be active in professional in court also, so that we can deliver. Finally, it is output which I was talking about. So our output also should be there. So still okay. Thank you very much. Once
again. Thank you, my lord. Thank you, my lord, for the wonderful session. And thank you to all the participants for joining us today. The session will be uploaded in our YouTube channel as well. The details of it will be shared soon. So thank you very much for joining us today, and hope all of you have a good evening today, and stay home and stay safe. Thank you so much. Thank you.